हेलो फ्रेंड्स, माय नेम इज़ डॉक्टर अक्षत मेहता। आई एम एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर एट रक्षा शक्ति यूनिवर्सिटी अहमदाबाद, विच इज़ इंडियाज़ फर्स्ट इंटरनल सिक्योरिटी यूनिवर्सिटी। टुडे आई टेक यू टू द इंट्रीगिंग एंड कॉम्प्लेक्स वर्ल्ड ऑफ साइबर पुलिसिंग एंड साइबर क्राइम इन्वेस्टिगेशन। फ्रेंड्स, द इंटरप्रटेशन ऑफ द टर्म स्पेस विज़र्विस क्राइम हैज़ अंडरगॉन ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन विद द एडवेंट ऑफ साइबर क्राइम। We are no more restricting ourselves to the geographical comprehension of the crimes as well as criminals. A criminal in the cyberspace is not confined to a geographical jurisdiction, as was the case with many of the conventional crimes. The developments in the world of information and communication technology have paid dividends to the humanity in various ways. Yet, at the same time, it has thrown before us huge challenges and present opportunities for crime using new and highly sophisticated technology tools. The same ICT tools are being used by the deviants to harass, threaten, dupe, damage their reputation, extort, indulge in illicit trade, recruit terrorists, and carry out security breaches and acts of terror. This has resulted in society looking at cybercrime as a significant challenge, and there is a dire need for governments to act speedily and strongly. The governments have responded by formulating laws and establishing institutional mechanism for addressing the challenges of the cyber world. However, considering that the cyber world is a dynamic world, much more needs to be done for cyber policing and cyber crime investigation. Now, what is cyber crime all about? When we see it in simple words, we can say that cyber crimes are unlawful acts wherein computer is either a tool or a target or both. In the first case, where computer is a target, the crimes include hacking, virus, worm attacks, denial of service attacks, etc. In the second scenario, computer is used as a weapon to attack other computers, and the cyber crimes would include cyber terrorism, intellectual property right violations, credit card frauds, electronics funds transfer frauds, pornography, to name a few. Computer crime is defined as any violations of criminal law that involve knowledge of computer technology for their perpetration, investigation, or prosecution. Stembock et al. States that electronic crime includes fraud, theft, forgery, child pornography or exploitation, stalking, traditional white-collar crimes, privacy violations, illegal drug transactions, espionage, computer intrusions, or any other offenses that occur in electronic environment for the purpose of economic gain or with an intent to destroy or otherwise inflict harm on another person or institution. Now, we can have a brief typology of cybercrime. David Wall has developed a four-category typology of cybercrime. The first category is cyber trespass, encompassing the crossing of the invisible yet salient boundaries of ownership online. The second and related category is cyber deception and theft. This form of crime includes all the various criminal acquisitions that may occur online, particularly for thefts due to trespass. The third category includes cyber porn and obscenity, and the fourth is cyber violence, representing the distribution of a variety of injurious, hurtful, or dangerous materials online. Now, literature mentions three generic types of cybercrime. First, crimes against the machine, which is integrity-related cybercrime. Second, crimes using the machine, which is computer-assisted cybercrime. And third, crimes in the machine, which is content-related cybercrime. Literature also talks about three main forms of economic cybercrime, that is, cyber-dependent crimes, largely via the internet; second, cyber-enabled crimes, which are facilitated by ICT-connected technologies, but are not dependent upon them, and therefore can exist in some non-cyber form as well; third, cyber-assisted crimes, which use networked digital technologies, such as mapping applications, in the course of criminal activity, which would take place anywhere. Now, cyber laws also needs to be looked in out here. The cyber crimes or the new age crimes are regulated by cyber laws or internet laws. However, it is relevant to point out here that cyber crime in Indian context is not defined either in the Information Technology Act of 2000 or its amendment in 2008 or in any other legislation as of now. Also, cyber crimes can involve criminal activities that are traditional in nature, such as theft, fraud, forgery, defamation, and mischief, all of which are subject to Indian Penal Code. Even an offense like stealing would fall within the broader purview of cybercrime if the basic data or aid to such an offense is a computer or information stored in a computer used by the criminal. The Information Technology Act defines computer, computer network, data information, and all other necessary ingredients that form part of a cybercrime. The IT Act came into being in the backdrop of growing computerization and the advent of e-commerce and e-governance in the last decade of the 20th century. Until then, most of the international trade and transactions were done through physical documents, and evidences and records were also predominantly in papers or hard copies only. With much of international trade being done through electronic communication, and with email gaining momentum, an urgent and imminent need was felt for recognizing electronic records. The United Nations Commission on International Trade Law adopted the Model Law on E-commerce in 1996. The General Assembly of the United Nations passed a resolution in January 1997, inter alia recommending all states in the UN to give favorable considerations to the said Model Law, which provides for recognition to electronic records and according it the same treatment like a paper communication and record. It is against this background the Government of India enacted its Information Technology Act in the year 2000 with an objective to provide legal recognition for transactions carried out by means of electronic data interchange and other means of electronic communication, commonly referred to as electronic commerce, which involve the use of alternatives to paper-based methods of communication and storage of information to facilitate electronic filing of documents with the government agencies, and further, to amend the Indian Penal Code, the Indian Evidence Act of 1872, the Bankers' Books Evidence Act 1891, and the Reserve Bank of India Act 1934, and for matters connected therewith or incidental thereto. The Information Technology Act 2000 was made effective from October 2000. However, being the first legislation in the nation on technology, computers, and e-commerce and e-communication, the act was subject to extensive debates, elaborate reviews and detailed criticisms. As a consequence, the IT Amendment Act 2008 came into being and was made effective from October 2009. The act focused on data privacy, information security, reasonable security practices to be followed by the corporates. It recognized the role of Indian Computer Emergency Response Team, included some additional cyber crimes like child pornography and cyber terrorism, authorizing an inspector to investigate cyber offenses as against the DSP earlier in the IT Act of 2000. Now, cyber offenses under IT Act include tampering with the computer's source documents contained in Section 65, hacking with computer systems and data alteration in Section 66, publishing obscene information in Section 67, unauthorized access to protected systems, Section 70, breach of confidentiality and privacy, Section 72, publishing false digital signature certificates, Section 73. Further, computer-related crimes which are covered under Indian Penal Code and special and local laws include sending threatening messages by email, Section 503 of IPC, sending defamatory messages by email, Section 499, forgery of electronic records, Section 463, bogus websites, cyber fraud, Section 420 of IPC, email spoofing, Section 463, webjacking, Section 383, email abuse, Section 500, and online sale of drugs under the NDPS Act and online sale of the Arms Act as well. Now, when we look at the cybercrime picture in India, the cybercrimes in India are growing, though in the overall crime statistics of India, the reported cybercrimes are minuscule. The statistics on cybercrimes are collected under three heads, namely, first, offences registered under the Information Technology Act of 2000, amended in 2008. Second, offences under the IPC related to cyber crimes. And third, offences under the special and local laws related to cyber crimes. Now, cyber crimes as percentage to total Indian Penal Code crimes were only 0.4% in the year 2015, and the total conviction rate was also poor at 36.6. Friends, this information can be interpreted in two broad ways. Firstly, the total reported cyber crimes are too less, that is only 11,592 in one full year, and that too in the country of the proportion of India. Further, a large section of the Indian society is venturing in cyberspace. This clearly leaves several questions unanswered relating to awareness as well as reporting of these crimes. Secondly, the poor conviction rate also points towards the difficulties in the domains of cyber policing and cyber crime investigation. Further, the data from National Crime Records Bureau reveals that in the total 8045 cases registered for offences under the IT Act in 2015, there were 5,102 persons arrested. These figures show an improvement over the year 2014, in which lesser number of cases were registered and lesser number of persons were arrested. The crime head in which maximum cases were registered in both the years 2014 and 15 under the Information Technology Act related to Section 66 to 66E. This was followed by publication, / transmission of obscene, / sexually explicit content under Section 67 to 67C of the IT Act. Now, what is cyber policing all about? The cyber world has brought a new paradigmatic shift in terms of connectivity, ease of providing services, and speed in the transactions. Yet, at the same time, there are growing threats and vulnerabilities. These have posed challenges for the law enforcement machinery like never before. This scenario raises questions relating to preparedness of police to address these challenges, the quickness of policymakers to adapt or amend the framework as per the needs of the time, and the ability of different governments and institutions to cooperate and coordinate with one another. The legislative framework in the form of Information Technology Act, through its various sections, has laid down the broad contours for cyber policing in India. Section 69 of the Information Technology Act empowers the government or agencies as stipulated in the section to intercept, monitor, or decrypt any information generated, transmitted, received, or stored in any computer resource, subject to the compliance of procedure as laid down in that section. This power can be exercised if the central government or the state government, as the case may be, is satisfied that it is necessary or expedient in the interest of the sovereignty or integrity of India, defense of India, security of the state, friendly relations with the foreign states, or public order, or for preventing incitement to the commission of any cognizable offense relating to above, or for investigation of any offense. In any such case too, the necessary procedure as may be prescribed is to be followed, and the reasons for taking such action are to be recorded in writing by order, directing any agency of the appropriate government. The subscriber or the intermediary shall extend all facilities and technical assistance when called upon to do so. These include 1. Providing access to or secure access to the computer resource containing such information, generating, transmitting, receiving, or storing such information. 2. Intercepting or monitoring or decrypting the information as the case may be. And 3. Providing information stored in the computer resource. The failure to extend the above mentioned facilities and technical assistance has been made punishable with an imprisonment for a term which may extend to 7 years and shall also be liable to fine. Section 69A inserted in the Information Technology Act 2008 vests with the central government or any of its officers with the powers to issue directions for blocking for public access of any information through any computer resource under the same circumstances as mentioned above. Section 69B discusses the power to authorize to monitor and collect traffic data or information through any computer resource for cyber security. The central government may, to enhance cyber security and for identification, analysis, and prevention of any intrusion or spread of computer contaminant in the country, by notification in the official gazette, authorize any agency of the government to monitor and collect traffic data or information generated, transmitted, received, or stored in any computer resource. As far as the question of cooperation between different institutions and governments is concerned, the issue of cybercrime takes us to the domain of not only intrastate or interstate, but international levels as well. Bennion et al. Has mentioned international cooperation between law enforcement agencies engaged in countering or investigating digital crime at three levels, that is macro, meso or micro level. At the macro level, cooperation is typically between governments and international organizations, including through the agencies of Europol and Interpol, etc. At the meso level, the cooperation is likely to be between police forces or law enforcement agencies located in different nation states. For example, between the PCEU in the UK and the FBI in the USA. At the micro level, the cooperation will often be between informal and take the form of contact between individual investigators. Bryant and Stephens has given this thing in 2014. At the international level, there has been a convention also called the Convention on Cybercrime, also known as Budapest Convention on Cybercrime, which is the first international treaty seeking to address internet and computer crime by harmonizing national laws, improving investigative techniques, and increasing cooperation among nations. The convention entered into force in July 2004. The convention is yet to get approval from international community as a whole, in the sense that countries like India too has declined to adopt it, as it was not involved in its drafting, and some countries like Russia have declined on the grounds that it may violate their sovereignty. Convention on cybercrime is one of the forms of international cooperation. The conventional thinking is that policing the cyber world is the task of public police, and it is essentially a government function. However, scholars have mentioned that monitoring of the cyber world can be undertaken by not just the state-funded policing or public policing, but by corporate policing as well as the non-governmental policing. Halder and Jaishankar in 2016 has pointed towards this trend. The success of cyber policing would depend upon building the synergies between public policing, corporate policing, and the non-governmental policing. Policing the cyberspace is becoming highly impossible due to the ease of offender mobility. Yar in 2005 has pointed towards this trend. Also, in spite of the cybercrime conventions, enmity or hostile relationship between the two countries may make policing cross-jurisdictional cybercrimes almost impossible. Chang in 2013 has pointed towards this trend. The cross-jurisdictional presence of the perpetrator, especially if the perpetrator is anonymous, makes it all the more difficult for cyber policing. Let's have an overview of the cybercrime investigation at this point. Now, O. Siadwine has argued that a good model of cybercrime investigations is important because it provides an abstract reference framework which is independent of any particular technology or organizational environment for the discussion of techniques and technology for supporting the work of investigators. One of the most theoretically grounded models was proposed by Siadwine in 2004. There are 13 activities in his extended model of cybercrime investigations, which are summarized here as under. First being awareness, which is recognition that an investigation is needed. Second is authorization, for example, through the issuing of a warrant. Then comes planning, which is using information which is collected by the investigator. Then is the notification, which is informing the subject and other interested parties that an investigation is taking place. Next comes search for and identify evidence. For example, locating the computer used by a suspect. Next comes collection of evidence, which is potential evidence which needs to be taken possession of. Then this evidence needs to be transported to an appropriate location. This is followed by storage of evidence through methods which should reduce the risk of cross-contamination. Then comes the examination of evidence, which is the use of specialist techniques, for example, recovery of the deleted data. Then a hypothesis has to be framed, a tested formulation of what may occur, and that needs to be presented. For example, such an hypothesis can be put before a defense or a jury. Then the hypothesis needs to be considered dissemination of the information needs to be brought about. It may influence investigation in the future as well. Now, the process of cybercrime investigation in India is vital to our understanding of this module. The power to investigate cyber offenses has been mentioned in Section 78 of the Information Technology Act, which says that notwithstanding anything contained in the Code of Criminal Procedure of 1973, a police officer not below the rank of inspector shall investigate any offense under this act. Further, Section 80 provides for the power of police officer and other officers to enter, search, etc. It says that notwithstanding anything contained in the Code of Criminal Procedure, any police officer not below the rank of this particular designation, that is inspector, or any other officer of the central government or a state government authorized by the central government in this behalf may enter any public place and search and arrest without warrant any person found therein who is reasonably suspected of having committed or of committing or of being about to commit any offense under this act. Further, subsection 2 of section 80 says, where any person is arrested under subsection 1 by an officer other than a police officer, such officer shall, without unnecessary delay, take or send the person arrested before a magistrate having jurisdiction in the case or before the officer in charge of a police station. Let's have some discussion on the salient points about this module. Now, as mentioned earlier, the domain of cyber policing and cyber crime investigation operates in a dynamic environment, and there are several issues and challenges to be addressed. These have been discussed one by one. Let's take the first issue, which is about the legal framework. Now, this issue in the cyber policing and cyber crime investigation is that of the legal framework under which the cyber crime scenario operates. In the Indian context, prior to the enactment of the Information Technology Act of 2000, the cyber world was unregulated and there was confusion amongst the law enforcement authorities regarding action to be taken on criminal acts committed in cyberspace. It was only with the legislative action resulting in IT Act 2000 coming into being that cyber crime was defined and cyber policing and investigation became a reality. Further, owing to its dynamic character, a need was felt to amend certain provisions of the Act, which was undertaken in the year 2008. In this Act, additional cyber crimes like child pornography and cyber terrorism were included, and an inspector was authorized to investigate cyber offenses as against the Deputy Superintendent of Police in the previous Information Technology Act of the year 2000. Thus, there are several questions which are sought to be addressed by the legal framework, like which act in cyberspace would be called a cybercrime, or how will that cybercrime be investigated, or what would be the penalty for committing such cybercrime, and what would be called evidence in the cyberspace, etc. Now, the second point for discussion is the nature of cyber policing. Now, which flows from the typology given by Haldar and Jaishankar also, a question which comes to our mind is that what is the nature of cyber policing? Should public policing alone tackle the menace of cyber crime, or is it in a position to manage it alone, or should private or corporate or NGOs be roped in for effective results as well? Certainly, the synergy between the three is likely to present solutions to address the challenges. The changing threat landscape, in the words of David Wall, and how it impacts the policing also needs to be kept in mind. This all clearly points towards broadening the breadth and scope of cyber policing and involvement of multiple stakeholders in addressing this menace. The third issue for discussion is cybercrime investigation. The power to investigate cyber offenses has been mentioned in Section 78, and Section 80 of the IT Act also provides for the power of the police officer and other officers to enter and search, etc. Now, with escalations in reports of serious cyber crime, one would expect to see a corresponding increase in the conviction rates as well. However, this has not been the case with many investigations, and prosecutions failing to get off the ground is a common scene out here. The chief causes of this outcome may be attributed to trans-jurisdictional barriers, subterfuge, and the inability of key stakeholders in criminal justice systems to grasp fundamental aspects of technology-aided crime. Most of the states are performing cybercrime investigation with one or very few dedicated cybercrime police stations, which may not be able to cope with the phenomenal increase in the offenses in the cyber world. Victims are also facing the problems of reaching out to the designated police stations for filing their complaints. Comedy in 2016 has brought this issue before us. The core challenges in cybercrime investigation are, first, there is a shortage of trained cyber investigators. Second, very few cyber forensic facilities are available in the forensic labs. Third, there are delays in receiving reports due to huge backlog. And fourth, there is lack of institutional mechanism to obtain help of cyber experts from the industry. Now, one more issue for discussion is coordination between countries or international agencies. We do have protocols for criminal investigation. Now, the cyberspace is altogether different space from the physical space, and so are the characteristics of the people traveling in it. The shedding of inhibitions, the blanket of anonymity, and geographic insulation offered by cyberspace has meant that crime and criminals are to be reinterpreted. The criminals in the cyber world and victims in the cyber world may not be in the same physical space. Rather, there is a possibility that they are poles apart. In this scenario, the investigation process has to deal with not only the laws of the states of one nation, but across the countries as well as in some cases. This requires greater amount of understanding, coordination, and cooperation between the legal functionaries of different states as well as the nations. Another point for discussion is capability of law enforcement machinery. Now, in the field of cyber policing and cyber crime investigation, a fundamental question is related to that of the capability of the machinery. The skill set of the people who are deployed in the cyber crime world or for crime investigation, cyber crime investigation cells, units, they are important determinants for the effectiveness of the machinery. We all know, friends, that the general recruitment standards set for police in the country are not going to help the matters. Indian police organizations require hiring and tapping the best talents in the field of cyber technology to counter the emerging threats from creative yet deviant minds. The author in one of his previous works has mentioned that cybercrime poses new challenges as the agencies to investigate such crimes lack the skills to do their job and poor policemen do not know what to do. Financial swindling and bungling also requires change in the traditional methods of investigation. Counterfeit currency has also emerged as a potent threat to India's internal security. Destabilization of Indian economy at a crucial period of its growth would be the last thing we should expect, and that is precisely what the forces inimical to India's emergence have been trying. Now, we all know that manpower or the persons are critical as far as the institutional framework is concerned. Sanctioning of the adequate manpower to these institutions is a basic requirement. The units and cells needs to be equipped with adequate and specialized manpower. In short, the global nature of computer crime and the digital environment, which has eclipsed the ability of any one department, state, or nation to individually manage this new paradigm change in crime, now requires more skilled and educated personnel. The provision of these new skilled and educated employees, not only for our forensic computer investigation units, but also for a range of sub-disciplines within the emerging body of knowledge, sometimes referred to as computer forensics, information assurance, computer security, and software security will have to come from our nation's universities only. Johnson in 2005 has pointed to this idea. For activities such as online information gathering, network forensics, mobile tracking, email tracking, social media analysis, and link analysis, regular police officers do not possess the required expertise. Hence, outsourced specialists with the latest technology know-how are handy for complex investigation. The cyber staff needs to be trained in forensic analysis, certificate course, network security certificate course, network tracking certificate course, call tracking training, and on-site analysis training. These are some of the emerging areas which people need to look into. Now let's look into the Supreme Court judgment of 2006 and the Model Police Act. The Supreme Court judgment in the Prakash Singh and others versus Union of India and others, dated 22nd September 2006, contained a directive which read, "The investigating police shall be separated from the law and order police to ensure speedier investigation, better expertise, and improved rapport with the people. It must, however, be ensured that there is full coordination between the two." Now, this judgment has pointed towards the need for specialization amongst our police personnel. The Model Police Act of 2006 also has emphasized upon the same. Several of the state legislatures have also incorporated these provisions in letter, though not in the spirit. The implicit point out here is that specialized skills needs to be imparted to the personnel, and in today's crime scenario, cybercrime policing and investigation is not an ordinary task. The manpower needs to be exclusively recruited and trained for this task and allowed to build upon their skills on a long-term basis. Friends, another point for discussion is evolving crimes. The cybercrime field has been evolving with time and bringing in more complexity. It has brought before us the challenges in the form of viruses, worms, phishing, hacking, malware, botnets, ransomware to name a few. The recent ransomware attack, WannaCry, affecting several countries is a proof of this evolution. Clearly, it requires capabilities of addressing these challenges. The policy framework, the institutional setup, the finances put in, and manpower recruited and deployed all need to be ready to innovate and adapt to the changed threat landscape. Friends, the support by countries for hacking and hacktivism, which has increased, is a dangerous trend. This is being observed in overt or covert manner, and there is a backing of cyber criminals by countries to damage the interest of the rivals or tilt the balance of power in their favor. This has resulted in ideological battles being played between the countries, and that too in the cyberspace. Terrorists, separatists, extremists are being supported by some countries to hack the networks of the opponents and damage their interests. This trend needs to be broken immediately. Now, one more point for discussion out here is how much policing? Several of the works which we undertake in cyberspace are personal in nature. Hence, a netizen expects a certain amount of privacy. Yet at the same time, owing to the threats emanating from the cyber world, policing is also required. So the question of how much policing should be there in the cyberspace is all the more relevant. A fine balance needs to be maintained between protecting the privacy of cyber users and need for keeping adequate vigil on the activities in the cyber world is there. Only a couple of years back, Supreme Court had struck down Section 66A of the Information Technology Act by calling it as unconstitutional in its entirety. It was also termed as a draconian provision that had led to the arrest of so many people for posting contents deemed to be allegedly objectionable. Friends, the social media is another platform which needs a clear vision as far as policing and investigation of the content is concerned. The law enforcement machinery is facing a huge challenge in keeping a tab over the developments on the social media. Some of the information on social media has the potential to cause huge law and order disturbances. Events in Kashmir Valley in the aftermath of the death of the terrorist Burhan Wani has shown the possibility of misuse of social media for mobilizing the anti-national elements in being aggressive against police and the armed forces. Now, towards the end, Peter Gottschalk has rightly pointed out that cyberspace presents a challenging new frontier for criminology, police science, law enforcement, and policing. Since the 1990s, academics and practitioners have observed how cyberspace has emerged as a new field of criminal activity. This space is changing the nature and scope of offending and victimization. A new discipline called cybercriminology, the term coined by Jayashankar in 2007, has emerged, wherein the study of causation of crimes is undertaken that occur in the cyberspace and its impact in the physical space is also being measured. The legislative framework is important and needs to be amended from time to time. Beyond legislative framework, even the national cyber security strategy is also important. In India, such a strategy aims to build secure and resilient cyberspace for citizens, businesses, and government. A cybersecurity document of a country like ours outlines and articulates the vision, objectives, guiding principles, and approach to meet cybersecurity goals. The development of cybercrime investigation modules, hands-on training to cybercrime investigators on cybercrime investigation and forensics, availability of necessary equipment with the state forensic science laboratories and infrastructure are other important determinants in effective cybercrime policing and investigation. In the end, it could be said that today, cyber policing and cybercrime investigation require more professionalism, more stealth, more usage of automated technology, and an ability to understand the complexity of the cyber world like never before. Thank you.